Falling victim to a scammer is an awful feeling. It's not only the theft of money or personal information that stings. The thought of being tricked by low-life crooks is enough to enrage anyone. Now, it's of little comfort, but if it's happened to you, know you're not alone in this scamdemic. According to the latest figures, over 95% of Australians are exposed to scams every year. There is positive news, though. A fight back is finally underway. And it's one that aims to turn Australia from an easy target into an impenetrable fortress. It's the fastest growing crime in Australia. There's no visible crime scene, no blood, no blaring sirens. But everyone is a target. Scamming has become a pandemic, costing Australians billions of dollars every year.
How am I going to get it back?
Tonight, what happens when you get a text or a phone call from hackers?
It's sickening. Tummy churning.
The Australians begging for help.
Been scammed?
They're meant to be protecting their customers' money, and they're not.
And our bank bosses explain why they won't pay up.
The customers trust your bank to protect their money.
Yep.
And
it's a chain.
Pointing at each other.
Oh, no, we're all working hard.
They tell you that your money is safe with the bank. Well, in my case, it certainly wasn't.
Yes, my internet's very slow.
Angela Ferrari feels like a fool. 3 months ago, she answered a phone call that would ruin her life.
They said they were from Optus and there had been several reports of slow internet in our area. The scam came through on my mobile phone and they kept me talking on the phone.
It was a friendly chat, the scammer offering Angela a refund because her Optus internet wasn't up to speed and convincing her to download an app on her phone to check her connection.
He had said he didn't need my banking details because he had the Optus account with the details on it to make this refund of $560-odd.
So it all sounded very legitimate.
To me it did, yes, very legitimate, yeah.
What do you mean it's all gone?
But that app gave the scammers everything they needed. Instead of getting a refund, Angela was locked out of her bank accounts. And when she rang National Australia Bank, the news was unbelievable.
I was asked if I had made a withdrawal of over $40,000.
At that point, what were you thinking? I mean, your heart must have dropped.
Well, yeah, it was pounding, I'm sure. I felt sick and I said there should be around about $100,000 left in that account. And she showed me it and there wasn't. They'd gone in twice and withdrawn in excess of $40,000 twice.
What was your response?
I nearly fainted.
Angela lost $98,000 in total, the scam slipping seamlessly through the bank's security systems.
No, they didn't ring me at all, and there was no SMS with a security code for either of those unauthorised transactions.
See, when I pay my mortgage monthly, I get sent a special code from the bank to transfer a few grand.
Yeah.
You're talking about amounts in excess of $40,000. There was
no communication.
Red flag?
No.
18th of March will be a date that I'm going to remember until I die.
It was an ordinary, busy Saturday afternoon. Tim Watkins was running errands when he received a text from National Australia Bank.
Basically, the text said, here is a verification code for a purchase you made with Amazon for $850. If you didn't make this purchase, please call this number. And it's a 1-300 number. So I called the number. Very professional person on the end of the phone. I asked him a couple of identification questions that I would always ask somebody from NAB, such as, please acknowledge who you are. And he came back and said that we would never ask for a password from you, which he didn't. And therefore, my assumption was he was a legitimate person from NAB.
But the Melbourne businessman was asked to provide a one-time passcode from his NAB app, which he did, and instantly regretted it.
I basically put the phone down, felt that something wasn't right. I immediately went home and found that both my personal and business accounts had been totally wiped out. There'd been 10 transactions that had been made for just over $220,000.
What was that moment like for you, Tim?
Horrendous. I mean, I can't really describe it. I mean, you can imagine you're staring at your screen and you see 10 transfers being made from 3 o'clock until 23 minutes past three.
Did you know you can apply for financial hardship assistance online? Check out nav.com.au.
For Tim and Angela, the scam was just the beginning of the nightmare as they took on the bank, desperate to track down their money.
At the end of your call, you may be prompted to participate in a one-minute survey about the service you've received today. The survey helps us improve our service.
I asked if I could go and have a meeting with somebody from their cyber security and fraud, and was basically palmed off. Nobody really called back, and I was just left sort of high and dry.
Tim was told there was nothing NAB could do to find his cash. That's despite 9 of the 10 transactions going to a UBank account, an online bank owned by NAB.
Why couldn't NAB track those transactions and find Tim's money?
The challenge that we have is that once the money goes to that recipient account, the scammers are sitting watching those recipient accounts, and as soon as the money arrives, they move it out. And they often convert it into cryptocurrency and it disappears overseas and it becomes impossible to recover.
Chris Sheehan knows a thing or two about chasing crooks. He spent nearly 30 years with the Australian Federal Police before heading up NAB's Investigations and Fraud Unit. He's adamant banks shouldn't be held responsible when scammers strike.
Why won't NAB reimburse scam victims?
Look, we are in the same position as all the other banks. Where we've made mistakes, and that happens from time to time, we will compensate the customer, either make partial or full reimbursement. But the reality is that in situations where the customer has authorised the payment themselves and we haven't made a mistake, then most of those cases we're not going to reimburse.
You've just recorded a big jump in profit to more than $4 billion. And couldn't you use a little bit of that $4 billion to help some innocent customers?
It's a great question. Look, the first thing I'd say is that we are. That $4 billion profit, a very significant portion of that is reinvested in the bank every year. And a large chunk of that is to improve the protections of our bank and our community and our customers from fraud and scams.
I always thought I was a bit smarter.
If the shock of losing her life savings wasn't bad enough, when Angela Ferrari asked for help, NAB staff didn't believe her.
And she called me into an office and said, "Is it possible your husband has stolen this money?" And I said, "No, absolutely not." And she suggested that I check his account.
Implying Angela's 80-year-old husband, Barry, a former mining manager, had stolen the lot.
So how did it feel when they suggested to you that...
Devastated.
Yeah. It's hard to talk about.
Well, it is emotional. You know, his husband of 40 years. It was a pretty awful thing to say.
Every Australian helped bail out your bank during the global financial crisis. Now some of your customers are in crisis and it sounds like you're washing your hands of it.
That's not true. Look, we care very, very deeply about what's occurring in this space and we're putting our money where our mouth is in relation to that. And what we're saying is that there are limits to what we can do to protect people, and we need everybody to come on the journey with us. And it's not just banks. It's telecommunications providers, it's online platforms, it's the government. And to be really honest, it's customers too.
It does sound a lot like privatising your profits and socialising your losses.
Look, I don't think that's right. We're not socialising the problem, but what we're saying is we're dealing with transnational organised crime. If we're going to tackle this problem, we need to be organised as well, and that means across the country, not just the banks.
We put our money into their banks. We trust them to manage our money and to not let things like what has happened to me happen. They've got to be responsible for it. I've been a NAB customer for probably 45 years. And if I owed them $10, they'd be on the phone looking for it.
They'd be right onto you.
Yes, yeah, they would.
For most of us, the sympathy we feel for victims, like Angela, is only matched by the anger we have for the banks. They rake in billions in profits every year, but seem reluctant to help loyal customers who've been scammed. Surely they could show some compassion. And if the big Australian banks are wondering how to do it, they should look to Britain.
This is a problem that's affecting the whole country. And as a bank, we recognised that the right thing to do was for us to take responsibility and put victims back in the position that they were in.
Paul Davis is Director of Fraud Prevention at Britain's TSB Bank. 4 years ago, with scams on the rise, TSB implemented mandatory payback for victims.
Since we've launched our guarantee 4 years ago, over 97% of fraud claims have been reimbursed by TSB.
So your scheme is really acknowledging and taking some responsibility and saying, yeah, look, as the bank, we are responsible. We have a duty of care.
That's right. We think it's the right thing to do for our customers who fall victim to crimes of this type. If you don't reimburse the victim as a bank, the cost is not zero. That customer is less likely to continue to bank with you. They're highly likely to complain. It's very expensive for us to run as a bank. And so the fraud refund guarantee, I think, is not just the right thing to do ethically and morally for the victims, but commercially, it's the simplest and lowest cost approach for us as a business.
In fact, it's been so successful, the British regulator has just announced from next year, all UK banks will be required to reimburse customers who've been tricked into sending money to scammers, who, as you'll see...
So that's ringing?
It is ringing.
...use some very devious tactics to snare their prey.
This is Jason.
Hey, Dan, nice to meet you.
We just scammed you. That was a scam call.
Don't be thrown by Jason Edelstein's family man persona. When he's not helping his son master jiu-jitsu, he's a black belt in the fight against cybercrime. In his day job at security firm CyberCX, Jason leads a team of 200 ethical hackers, computer experts using their skills for good. And to show just how easy it is for scammers to get access to your personal information, today they're setting up a sting on one of our unsuspecting 60 Minutes team.
All right, so how will this work?
Okay, so the premise of the scam is that we're going to spoof your telephone number, we're going to call Dan, who's a colleague of yours, and we're going to ask him to disclose your passport number that you need while you're out on the road. And we've got some fabricated voice samples that we're going to produce using artificial intelligence. It'll sound very, very similar to your voice. That combined with the call spoofing will give real credibility to the scam.
All right, should we give it a go?
Absolutely.
Let's call him.
Okay.
So that's ringing.
It is ringing.
Hey, Dan, got a sec? I'm just on my way to the shoot and I need my passport number quickly. Any chance you'd have the number handy?
What number are you looking for?
I need my passport number quickly. I can't get onto Karen or Steph in the office. Any chance you'd have the number handy?
I honestly, I can't really hear you. I don't know what number.
Hey, sorry, let me call you back.
Despite having trouble hearing the call, Dan falls for it. He thinks the AI voice is me.
So he's texted me straight away, sent me my passport number. So how did you get my name, my number to pop up on someone else's phone? How do you do that?
So we used a technique called call spoofing, and we used a platform to basically modify the caller ID records to change the number to be your number when I'm calling him.
And even though he couldn't hear me very well, he clearly believed it was my voice. How did you copy my voice like that?
So basically what we did is we used artificial intelligence. Well, firstly, we started with some voice samples that we found online. We then fed that into a program, and then we basically built out a blueprint of your voice.
Give me 2 seconds. Let me know when you've got the number.
It's sophisticated yet surprisingly simple.
No worries.
And even our extremely tech-savvy team member, Dan, took the bait.
This is Jason.
Hi, Jason. Nice to meet you. Nice to meet you.
We just scammed you. That was a scam call. Did it sound like me?
It did.
Did you believe it was me?
It was a bit weird when I said I couldn't understand you, but yeah, it just sounded like you were on the road and I didn't know where you were.
And you sent me my passport number.
I did.
So it was an AI spoof call. And you fell for it.
Yep. Hook, line, and sinker.
And that's where our telecommunications companies come into play.
We're already blocking 10 million scam calls a month. We're blocking over 20 million scam SMSs a month. I think everyone can always do better, so we do a lot. Is there more we can do? There always will be.
Once a warfare officer in the Royal Australian Navy, Narelle Devine is now at the helm of security operations for Australia's biggest telco.
How do you block or stop those texts from being sent by scammers?
We have a great threat intelligence capability here at Telstra that allow us to look at where those known bads are originating from, and we can really narrow that blocking down to we know that that particular thing is going to send out bad. We will not let it through.
It's a relentless battle against nifty crime syndicates and evolving technology. The good news is Narelle says they are slowly winning the war, but there's a long way to go. And she's quick to point out telcos are only one link in the chain.
Was the message delivered by a telco? Well, sometimes, but sometimes it might be an app or another provider. So where did that message come in? You know, could it have been correlated back to, you know, a financial institution to stop the payment? Well, sure, in some cases I'm sure it could, in others it can't. So every use case is so unique, it's really hard then to say it was this person to blame.
It's clearly a complex and critical battle. But getting everyone to agree how to fight it has been challenging.
You can't say to one bit of the system, you're responsible for the whole thing.
In a sign of just how seriously financial institutions are taking this pandemic, for the first time, Westpac CEO Peter King has allowed cameras inside the bank's cyber command centre. Last year, the team here stopped 60% of scams, or $200 million, from leaving Westpac accounts. As for the other 40%, well, for now, it's tough luck.
We have people monitoring transactions, we have people calling customers saying, don't do it, we block them. But one of the challenges we have in a real-time payments environment is things move quickly. We're also putting blocks in and we call it friction, but we're going to slow some parts of the system down so we can do some more checking. And we'll get back what we can, but it's quite hard.
While the banks are very focused on stopping scammers, when they can't, there's still the delicate question of how to handle victims.
Why won't you reimburse customers who've been scammed?
Well, we look at it, and if it's a fraud, we do reimburse. If it's a scam, we'll look at it and say, did we contribute to it? And in that case, we do reimburse. But if there is contribution across this chain, you know, if you think about social media, think about telco, you think about banks, and you think about the customer, it's often not one thing that goes wrong. It's parts in all this. There might need to be a contribution.
Peter concedes the bank could and should do more to help victims. But he says real reform will only come when the government gets tough.
We really need to make Australia a hard place for scammers. Telcos have got a role, banks have got a role, and the government can really help in making sure the legislation is fit for a digital world.
With the calls for action getting louder, cyber criminals are on notice.
This is no different to money laundering or terrorism or drug importations. It's a crime, and if you know that your service is being used by criminals, you should stop it. Now, the question is, how?
Targeting innocent Australians like Angela Ferrari has been a walk in the park for cyber criminals.
It's been devastating, Amelia. It's just been something that I could have really lived without. For both of us, it's been a terrible time.
$98,000.
Yeah, it's a life changer.
It's an eye-watering sum.
Yeah, yeah. And it's just at our stage in life, we're not going to be able to go back to work and make it up.
Angela's story is all too common. Australians lost a record $3 billion to scammers last year, and that's just the reported cases. But that's about to change, if you believe Assistant Treasurer Stephen Jones, who's on a mission to overhaul the entire system. He's launching the government's new $86 million National Anti-Scam Centre in Canberra.
Is $86 million enough to fight a $3 billion worth of crime?
When we came into government, it was zero, and we want to ensure that we're building the Commonwealth's capacity up in this area. It's a whole-of-country effort, so the government's investment needs to be matched by what's happening in the private sector across banks, telecommunications companies, social media platforms as well.
What the minister has achieved is bringing everyone to the same table for the very first meeting of the Scam Centre Task Force.
I haven't seen the regulators working as closely together on an issue as we are in relation to scams.
The plan is to share intelligence and strategies in real time. Whether or not it will work remains to be seen.
It's affecting all the fabric of our society. If this was an offline crime that was affecting over two-thirds of adults in the country, there'd be people protesting outside Parliament Houses, demanding action.
Alastair McGibbon is Chief Strategy Officer at CyberCX. He spent more than 20 years advising government and the private sector how to navigate and defend against cybercrime.
Did you ever think we would get to this crisis point?
In my view, the market has failed. I think for a long time we hoped that all these individual institutions would rise up individually and collectively to protect us. It's time for the government actually to do something. So if you're a telco, you must drive down SMS fraud scams. You must drive down those fake phone calls. If you're a banker, then you must do things about ensuring there's multi-factor authentication on bank accounts, that you probably should push some, and this might sound controversial, push some friction into banking.
Stephen Jones is promising to do that, with a new industry code of practice to be implemented and enforced within months.
Who will become responsible? The banks or the telcos? Because at the moment you have all these victims who are told they're responsible and they're not being reimbursed.
Great question. We are looking at right across the board, lifting the bar to ensure the banks, the telecommunications companies and social media platforms are held accountable, and we've raised the standard on what's expected of them. They have to be able to keep their customers' money safe.
And if they don't?
There'll be financial penalties and there'll be compensation requirements upon them if they are not meeting that standard.
Are Australian banks doing enough to stop and respond to scamming?
I guess as a consumer, most of the time that focus goes on to the bank because they're the ones that let my money go, but it's probably unfair to put all of the blame on the banks having to stop money leaving financial institutions. If all of these organisations did more to stop fraud inside their own ecosystem, they would drive down some scams. But the thing about scammers is they'll move around barriers. And so what you need is a systemic response. And we've not been able to achieve a systemic response in Australia to date. So the way I describe this in simple terms is, how do we make criminals burn more calories per dollar? How do we make them expend more effort, more cost for the return on their investment?
Disruption of individual scam campaigns.
The hope is the answers will be found and executed in this room. The danger is lots of buzzwords and bureaucratic dysfunction. It's all too little, too late for Angela Ferrari, but she's hopeful for others who make the same mistake.
That old saying, it's only money. But you've lost so much more than money, haven't you?
Yeah. I guess, in a way, we are fortunate that we have still got our health and we can still get out and about and do things, but...
But you've also lost a future, essentially.
Yeah. I really think your money's going to be better off down the back of the couch than with some of our banks.
Hello, I'm Amelia Adams. Thanks for watching 60 Minutes Australia. Subscribe to our channel now for our brand new stories and exclusive clips every week. And don't miss out on our extra minute segments and full episodes of 60 Minutes on 9now.com.au and the 9Now app.